We had royalty in on Friday in the shape of Fred Dinage. We have now kind of the equally royal, but a little bit younger, a little bit more fresh-faced. Roy Stry from Scouting for Girls. Afternoon, Roy.
Hello, mate. Pop royalty.
Pop royalty.
I'll take that.
You'll take that any day.
Even though I came up with that, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Welcome to Wave 105. Thank you for coming in. We're going to be talking new album. We're talking new single. But let's just say that for you, quite frankly, these are the best of times, aren't they?
They are amazing times, yeah. It's been... I honestly think it's one of the best years we've ever had as a band. We started off the year touring with Ollie Mears.
Yes.
On his arena shows. We've done... Our tour coming up in November is pretty much sold out.
Yeah, I know.
We've got a new album coming out, which is like... It, just the pre-orders alone.
Yeah.
I just literally came from a record label meeting and they're very excited. You always know when people are excited because there's more and more people at the meeting.
Okay.
They came a couple
better
of years ago. There was nobody.
Better refreshments as well? Or?
It was on Zoom.
So, okay.
Yeah. So I was like a big head in a meeting room, which I quite liked.
Yeah, yeah.
Like a Bond villain.
Yeah.
And there were lots of people going, yes, Roy, that's a good idea. So there are people who are really excited about it. We're just having the best time playing live.
I was going to say, I looked at the tour and I was thinking, oh, I'll plug the O2 Academy in Bournemouth, get some bums. Oh, no, it's sold out already, so we can't do much about it. These are big venues as well. Don't sound surprised. But, you know, these are the tour schedule that, you know.
It's been one of the most amazing years. I think we've got people who love the band to begin with.
Yeah.
And... You know, that album was one of the last big sort of CD sale eras. And so we do more university shows now than ever before. And I think you've got these kids coming through saying, you know, I grew up listening to you. It was like the CD which was in the car. So we did loads of universities now. And even like the shows now, they're getting younger and younger in terms of like people who are at the front. So, yeah, it's like... We're super grateful.
I mean, there's a festival not far from here, Wavefest. You've become the Wavefest festival band. Yeah, I mean, I've seen you there every year. I go, who have they got on? Someone, Scouting for Girls
it's
again.
It's getting a little bit embarrassing with Wavefest because that was our fourth year in a row that we played that festival.
Yeah, but you're the banker for them.
Do you know they've even asked us to do it next year?
And they're brilliant.
I'm like, we can't do it 5 years in a row because doing a festival back to back is kind of... pretty unheard of to do it, but people seem to love it.
For those that know Wavefest or don't know it, the only other band that get close to Scouting for Girls are Leather Rat. They're the only other ones that play that often, and there's a reason they play that often, because they can't stand up by the end of it. Unlike you boys, casting aspersions
still going,
here.
Still going, yeah.
Scouting for Girls, Elvis Ain't Dead. Just to remind you of halcyon days gone by, halcyon days that are here. Roy from Scouting for Girls is here this afternoon. This Ain't a Love Song.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That really was it's weird because that was the number one.
Yeah.
But it isn't necessarily your calling card all the time, isn't it?
No.
It's a weird one, that.
Yeah.
Did that ever become an albatross at any point? Or?
No. I love albatross.
Albatrosses that pay.
Yeah. I'll have a few more number one albatrosses if possible. I know it was a weird one. That, do you know, every time we've tried to go for success, never really works. Like, Elvis Ain't Dead, She's So Lovely. Those songs, we were just trying to write songs for our friends down the pub, really. And they were the ones that connected. And the same with This Ain't a Love Song. That wasn't even supposed to be a single. And I think the label called it a setup single.
Okay.
And came out before the album. Then it just came out, because it was on the back of, you know, all that success. And it just went in at number one, which was, I think, a massive shock to everybody.
Yeah. You seriously surprised?
Oh, my God, yes.
Yeah?
Yeah, oh, no, I don't think anybody, you know, they hoped it would go in the charts, but it was setting up for the album, which was supposed to come out after it. So, yeah, I was so shocked. I was even more shocked. Then there was supposed to be a big single which came off afterwards, which was called Famous, which we still play live, but that was the one which was, everyone was like, if This Ain't a Love Song's number one, Famous is going to be like number one everywhere in the world, and it came out and did nothing. it was like number 37 in the charts, and that was more of a shock, especially for the record label.
I was looking at the discography, and you've got quite an extensive one now.
Yeah. We're coming up to studio album 7, which is, and we've managed two greatest hits already. Yeah. We just got to go three, we beat Queen, you know, and Yeah, I think, and we've done a couple of, I think we did a live album last year for our 15th anniversary. So, yeah, it's honestly a joy, and it's more fun. I think it's even more fun now than it's ever been before.
Yeah.
So we just, we love it.
Joining us live this afternoon, and a few questions coming in. We'll get through those in the next half hour or so. Roy Stride, lead singer, songwriter. All-round good guy from Scouting for Girls. Yeah. Actually, your songwriting, it blossoms far and wide, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Drop some names. Who have you written for?
Most recently, I was involved with the Jack Jones, Callum Scott single Whistle.
Yes.
Which did really well.
Did.
But my first ever cut, as it was for a little band called One Direction.
Yeah.
Which is quite a good thing to...
Yeah.
And then through that, I did lots of stuff for 5 Seconds of Summer.
Yeah.
It's an amazing, I get as much enjoyment out of that as I do, actually that's a lie.
Yeah, no,
I love
it
being
is.
In a band.
Yeah.
I do, yeah. It is
So somebody comes to you, says, Roy, can you knock up a song for XYZ?
Yeah.
Do you get to a point in that song sometimes you think, actually, this is too good, I'm keeping this, I'll write a different one for them?
Sometimes, yeah. Sometimes, but I generally, the problem with being a songwriter, or maybe a narcissist, I don't know which it is, but every time I start a song, I always think it's the best song that has ever been written. And that is what keeps you so excited, because you start it, and you're like, this is incredible. And it's only as you go down the line, like a couple of weeks in, that people go, actually, that's no good.
Yeah.
And then you realise. So...
But you had that feeling about Glow, the new single, didn't you?
You
said that was a moment that you thought, wow, this is good.
And that's it. And as I said, I get that with every single song. But it was only when...
They put it in the press release before you decided otherwise, so...
Well, the great thing about being in a band with two of your oldest friends is if it is... They just tell you the truth.
Yeah.
And they're very happy to tell me if a song's rubbish or not. And they love it.
I'm sure they are.
Yeah. So it stayed.
The new album, which is coming out shortly, The Place We Used to Meet, has got this track on it as well, The Missing Part.
Yep.
Yeah. What's the story behind that?
Story behind The Missing Part is, well, after we've written Glow, which is obviously the best song ever written,
ever.
Even according to Greg and Pete, Glow is more in like the This Ain't a Love Song vibe. It's kind of a bit more of a classic ballad and that sort of song. And I felt we needed a real pop song. And so we're in our band, our live band at the moment, we've got a guy called Nick Sang. Now, Nick originally started life. He was the guitarist in Busted.
Right.
He was the extra guitarist, you know. And so he played, and he's got a real love of that sort of pop punk sound. And when he was in the band last summer, I was like, I'm looking for a really big pop song, like the biggest pop song we can get. And he sent me a few tracks, which he'd got, and like just instrumentals. And he sent me The Missing Part instrumental. And within about an hour, I'd written the second best song of all time.
Okay.
and put it together. And I sent it to him, and he was like, this is great. And so that's how it started life. So
let's climb that chart with the second best song of all time. You know what? If I couldn't love Scouting for Girls anymore, I love the fact you write songs that come in typically around 3 minutes, perfect for the radio.
I know, it's a bit of a short ending, that, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It almost got me.
Well, that's how we wrote it, because like Nick just sent me the track. It didn't have an ending, so just ended like that. And we were like, do we need to put anything on there? I was like, no, that's great.
Yeah, well, so you didn't give much time to that, did you? Just thought, sod it, it's the end of
bit
it.
Bit of reverb.
Just,
keep people on their toes.
And that's a weird one, if you ever play it live then, that people think, is that finished? Are we waiting for it to kick back in?
Or? No, because we got the biggest, we had the best fun with this. So we recorded a live video, which I think has just gone on our socials, which you can see. And basically, during the middle part of that song, we got everybody in the crowd to go down low, which I've never done before.
No.
I've never had the balls to get everyone to do that. And got everybody to go down low. And then after a count of four, everybody jumped up. So we had like 10,000 people at one time. So we recorded that. And then we did the big mother of all endings for The Missing Part live. So
brilliant.
It's a good one. A
couple of WhatsApps in here. Rob says, do you enjoy doing the cover versions, the likes of Living on a Prayer that they've seen you do?
Yeah. Well, we did it. We actually ended up doing, during COVID, a whole album of cover versions called Easy Cover, because it was just 80s cover versions, including a fairly bad one of Easy Lover by Phil Collins. That's why we called the album Easy Cover. But we love it. Like, live, it's all about, for us, just connecting with the fans and connecting with people there and, you know, trying to create as big a party as possible. So We always do.
Roy Stride is here from Scouting for Girls. You could have brought the others along, really, couldn't you? If you'd known we had such a nice new studio.
I should have. They'd have loved to have come along.
Yeah.
I was saying, like, Pete's got his caravan down in Hailing Island.
Has he really?
Yeah, so we do, actually.
We'll be neighbours soon. That'd be great. Me and Pete could hang out. In on the beach, maybe, or the ferry in.
We love it down here, so, and we're not too far, but... Yeah, I think they're chilling before the tour.
Are they?
That's the plan.
I was going to say, I noticed that, who was it I saw today, that a band that said, oh, we're into rehearsals for the tour. And I looked at them, I thought, you don't need to rehearse anymore, surely. But you still feel the need that you've got to get in the studio.
We have, people always laugh about this. So tomorrow in our calendar, it says band practice.
Yeah.
And we still call it band practice, which people laugh at because that's what you call it when you're at school.
Yeah.
But we've always called it band practice. And so, yeah, we do... It's probably our second band practice of the year. But we've got a tour, so we've got to learn a few new songs.
Yeah.
And I love it. Because that used to be... Before the band took off, our band practice was like our Friday night. So we used to go to a rehearsal studio, take a few beers, play for like 3 hours, loads of music. It got worse and worse. This is probably why it took us such a long time to get a record deal. And that used to be our Friday nights. And so we love a band practice. It's... Yeah, it's great fun.
The Place We Used to Meet is out this month. We've got the new single from it, After Five. Stick around, it's well worth listening to. Roy Stride from Scouting for Girls. Look, if you've got a bucket list, put it on to go and see Scouting for Girls live. I've seen you far too many times, and you've never done a rough deal. You must love that part of it.
I do. And also, I think... Because it took us a long time to get a record deal and get to a point where we ever had an audience, and as a massive music fan myself, I know what it's like to go and see a band and they'd be rubbish.
Yeah.
Or worse, we were discussing one artist who doesn't play any of their big songs.
Yeah.
And so we always love to give people their money's worth. Not because we just want people to hear the hits, but for me, the connection is seeing people love the music you're playing and connect, and they've come to see the songs that they've grown up listening to, and it's, I never get bored of it. I never get bored of like She's So Lovely or seeing people with that genuine joy. And as I get older, I feel like there's this like spiritual connection between us and the fans and that joy which is created. So,
and also, there's nothing worse than going to see a band and they don't do the big hits.
You
guys, you do that and then you'll pop in a cover version of whether it be Living on a Prayer or whatever. When you come off stage after that, does it take you a while to come down? Are you buzzing?
I'm pretty buzzing. I'm pretty knackered as well, to be honest, as I'm getting older. But also, I think I've got a lot fitter in the last couple of years. I'm probably probably in better health than I've ever been. And that means that the shows are even more energetic, which means I'm even more tired at the end. But
I know a few friends of mine who think you're well fit.
Is that exercise-wise?
No.
Take
that whichever way you want.
I don't even know what to say about that. But I honestly am enjoying it live now more than ever. And Nick, who I was mentioning before, who we co-wrote The Missing Part with, the new guitarist, he's really brought another element to us. And we're just loving it.
The Place We Used to Meet, the new album out on the 13th. Is it like bringing a new child into the world?
It is a bit, but it's kind of, you are a bit nervous how people are going to take to it. And I'm really proud of it, but also a little bit sick of it now, which I should never say, but it's been like 4 years in the making, like, because we did a cover album, but that was kind of quite a fun lockdown project. But this is probably the best songs we've had over the 4 years.
And yeah.
The first part of the album was just like the best six songs we've written over the last 5 years. And so I feel it's really good. It's probably the best record we've done.
If you're worried about the reception for the album, you've only got to look at the ticket sales for the tour think, we will tell you there are limited tickets for the Brighton Dome on the 15th of November.
Yeah.
There are limited tickets for, only popping down the road for you, G Live in Guildford on the 29th. If you're hoping to go on the 1st of December to the O2 Academy, it's sold out.
Yeah, I think... I think G Live is sold out as well.
Is it? Yeah. Okay, since that. Oh, well. It's Brighton then, if you want to.
But do you know what? Come into our mailing list, because I think we are going to add a few more dates on the week that the album is being released. So,
all right. And on that album is the greatest song ever written. Glow.
Glow.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Not my words, the words of Peter Ellard, drummer of Scattered Girls.
And this, as I said earlier, this was the moment when you obviously realised this was a good song.
Yeah, I felt it was a good song. It came from a really honest place.
Yeah.
And it's probably one of the first overt love songs I've ever written for my wife. And we met actually when I was on tour with the band in Japan, and she actually worked for the record company. And so the video which we did for it, I actually went back to the place. It was the most romantic thing I ever did. So we first kissed in an elevator in a hotel above the Shibuya Crossing in Tokyo, where all the Scramble Crossing. And a couple of years later, I took her back there to the place where we first kissed, and that's where I asked her to marry me. Mm. And so it was about...
Can you hear that? Oh, everywhere across the south.
Yeah, and probably, as my wife says, probably the only romantic thing I've ever done. I kind of saved it up for that. But then I wrote her this song. And the song is about how... It's about that kiss, about how you could almost... You know, I think the line is there, I could taste forever in that kiss. And it was like, you never know with those kisses, no, whether it's your last first kiss. And that
God, even I'm getting gooey now.
Yeah, it's horrible, isn't it? Horrible.
Listen, the place we used to meet, order it. Get it in your saved list to make sure you've got a copy on October the 13th. We played the missing part earlier. That's on there. So's this, the new single. Roy, listen, all I can say is thank you again for coming in.
Thank you for having me. It's lovely being here.
Good. You like our new studio? It's all right. It's better than the old one, isn't it?
It's one of my favourite parts of the world around here. So, you know, thank you for... You know, for all the love and support over the years.
Yeah, you've given us some love. You've done loads of gigs. We've done Bournemouth BH Live, didn't we? We've done The Beach as well at the Air Show. Yeah. God, some memories there. Listen, this is Glow from Wave 105, Scouting for Girls. Roy Stry, thank you so much.
Wave 105.